In one fell swoop, Brook lost nearly everything. His crew annihilated, ship ruined. All he had left was his hair, roots deep, and a tone dial to preserve the spirit of the Rumbar Pirates. After 45 years of isolation, he had his first contact since death. Yet those who seemed so inhuman had nothing to offer for him, only taking more from a man already at rock bottom. Stripped of his shadow, a piece of his soul that allowed him to stand in the light, he lost just a bit more hope. Another obstacle put in front of him on his path to return to Laboon. Yet even without his shadow, once returned to the sea, Brook's day-to-day life hadn't changed. Where so many had been confined to the Florian Triangle through Moria's theft of their shadows, the fog perfect for blocking out deadly sunlight, Brook had been a prisoner of that region before Moria had ever been born. While so many had their lives completely changed through Moria's entrapment, Brook wasn't one of them, though he was burdened all the same. Near the end of that dreary period came a point of light, the Straw Hat stumbling across him, giving him the first real food and companionship he'd had in years. Yet he could not accept that happiness, those bonds he could potentially form as a member of the Straw Hat Pirates, instead claiming that his tears had all dried up. Not knowing if he could ever reach Laboon, not knowing if Laboon was even still alive, how could he simply accept such happiness with so much uncertainty in the future ahead? Stripped of their shadows, their freedom, those shards of their soul would go on to fill the hearts of the zombies, Morian Hogback using their talents and power to make others suffer, desecrating the dead through creating the inhuman, monsterish zombies. Much like Brook, they too were gripped by their losses. Having lost his crew to Kaido, Moria sought an army of expendable men he would feel nothing for. Hogback, desiring Sindri, who'd rejected his advances, after her death, Moria gave him the chance to revive her, the zombie possessing none of Sindri's heart, only Margarita's hatred for plates and men who she associated with the master who'd cast her out. Controlled by their grief, they rejected the death around them, and in doing so, rejected life. Unable to change and move on from their pain, they enforced that same stagnancy on those they captured, leaving them trapped and unable to see the light. Change is a natural course of life, yet Hogback sought a slave, someone who would concede to his every whim and demand, not once caring for the humanity of Sindri, the kindness she showed him far from touching a heart only interested in her body and looks. The shadow is something naturally reactive to whatever it spawns from. Split from the body, those shadows, without anything to reflect, would remain unchanging. Evoking a microcosm of the conflict at the core of Thriller Bark, Margarita, separated from her shadow for 10 years, struggled to live in the light, finding a new master. When her shadow returned, she broke the plates accidentally, not dissimilar to the incident 10 years ago that filled her shadow with grief. But her new master didn't care about the plates, being grateful for Margarita in his life and glad for her sake. But while the return of her shadow had finally given her the chance to live again, even without it she had still been capable of change that her shadow hadn't experienced. Still stuck in the same grief 10 years later where Margarita had become able to live with the plates she once hated and made a new bond, forming another relationship in the same vein as the one that hurt her so much so long ago. While stolen shadows pushed those missing them to stagnate, Margarita possessed the strength to surpass those circumstances and move on where Brook, Lola, Moria, Hogback, and so many others could not. Though Lola fought from the forests of Thriller Bark, planning her move, the difference in mindset between those who had lived without shadows and those who fought regardless of their circumstances was shown during the battle against Orrs. After he got back up following Nightmare Luffy's pummeling, Lola and the Victims Association prepared to retreat, where the Straw Hats had already begun moving into position to strike back from the moment Orrs had stood. Though Brook had joined them, the Brook of that moment was one slightly different from the one who'd been trapped in the Florian Triangle for 5 decades. Rejecting Luffy's offer to join the Straw Hats, Brook, who'd failed to get his shadow back 5 years ago, once again attacked Thriller Bark, and once again failed. Not willing to sacrifice his afro and risk being forgotten to Laboon, Brook didn't want to lose anything else. But fighting alone, he was still unable to change, unable to gain anything else. Just as losing his shadow hadn't enacted any kind of marked difference in his life, in pulling away from the kindness of the Straw Hats he remained stuck, unwilling to form connections like those that had hurt him in their loss. Where Margarita had made a new connection, where Moria and Hogback were still held in place by their pasts, for Brook, though opportunity had presented itself, he still remained on the Rumbar pirate ship in spirit even as he fought Ryoma once again on Thriller Bark. Ryoma used all of Brook's techniques without the struggle in learning them, the histories, that style, all in a body that evoked the history of Wano, yet had none of the memory of that place or those fighting arts. But Brook's stagnancy could not overpower that swordsman, as much of a mockery as it was. And in the face of his defeat, Brook lamented that if he failed, there was no point to his life, one that only remained to carry the will of those left behind, that burden something he would not let any others bear. But even if he had tried to pull away, unasked, the Straw Hats had in part explored Thriller Bark in hopes of finding a way to get his shadow back. Brook, alone for 50 years, could not beat Ryoma alone, but Zoro could. Even if Nightmare Luffy alone could not beat Oars, together the Straw Hats could. Through unity and bonds, the Straw Hats could exceed Moria. Through this new connection, Brook could finally move on from the fog he'd been stuck in for so long. And accepting help from even just one other, he was able to keep the Afro Ryoma demanded he sacrifice. In accepting help from that one other, Brook got that much closer to reaching Laboon where he hadn't before. At the darkest moment, just before dawn, the Straw Hats continued to resist Moria, even as the rising sun threatened to destroy them. Trapped under the main mast, Moria barely held on to the shadows that served as a thin line between life and death for those that opposed him. Had he held on for just a little longer, he might have won, but instead, he released them. Known to be lazy, rather than defeat Luffy himself, he wanted Luffy to know the same pain and failure he did in losing all of his comrades, setting the stage so that someone else might do it. Even if his operation was now crumbled around him, even in his loss he tried to make others more like him, to better understand his own pain. But ironically, in that defeat, though he'd done so much to try and ensure he never felt the pain of loss again, he'd still found comrades who would help him, proving his actions wrong as his attempt to enforce stable stagnancy still resulted in change. Being taken to safety by Hogback and Absalom, those he'd once taken in and used for their skill and powers, they now remained as his crew, forming a bond so strong that he would go beyond himself for their sake as they protected him. And all the while, his proclamation to Luffy would come true shortly after the events of Thriller Bark, where Luffy came to know his loss. But though that pain can sound deeply, echoing harshly for a long time, that discordant sound eventually fades. So much like tears, though the sad ones can go away, the happy ones can always burst out. Brook once told the Straw Hats that he had no more tears to shed, even in happiness. But once he learned of Laboon, still alive, still waiting for him, what Brook thought had dried up started to flow forth. Almost synonymous with Brook is the song of Bink's Sake, one that, in its last verses, calls attention to death and loss. Though partings with those who will never meet again will no doubt happen, the moon will rise again, time continuing on. One day we'll all be skeletons, but fear of that potential loss shouldn't interfere with one's ability to end the nightmare and find room to dream again. As always, I'd like to thank my patrons, Dojo32161, Thanks Nitrorad, Bayonort, Brorike, Offline But Not, Justice Man, Flarbu, Mohammed Akeem, Tengoon, Brian Nesseth, and Sam Bellmeyer. Thank you for watching.